Remember the old days when you could just jump on RuneScape, Halo 3, World of Warcraft? Your friends list was lit up like a Christmas tree, just little green circles, and you had ILILILILILIZZI was online. You remember those usernames? God, those suck to type in. You jump on TeamSpeak, plug in your terrible microphone, turn on a day to remember, and just drown out the world, all right? I still use a day to remember to drown out the world, and I'm 27. Then months would pass and life went on. You got older, and the days of playing those video games every single day just got a little bit less frequent, all right? Over time, the days of games got less, and staring at lawn got more often. Now, we look back at those moments and reminisce about the old, you ready for this? Good old days. While we drink a beer, jump on free-to-play RuneScape, and then just quit after Tutorial Island, because in all honesty, it's really not that exciting. It's like, that is what's happening to Aftermarket Wheels, and it's kind of a sad day. I'm Alex, Alex at Defy on Instagram, and today we're gonna be talking about why Aftermarket Wheels could potentially kind of sort of being dying. And if you're looking for aftermarket wheels, tires, or suspension, be sure to hit us up over at fitmentindustries.com, where we literally have it all, including coilovers, air suspension, wheel tire packages. Send them to your door, you know? There, the good, good. Anyway, let's chat about this. It's actually kind of a sad introduction, but it's happening a little bit around here, all right? When you take it back to the early days of aftermarket wheels, whether that's the 50s of Enkei and American Racing, 70s of Work, Volk, XXR, the 2010s of Rotiform, or even the 2020 of Artisa Wheels, there's always been a common theme, making badass aftermarket wheels. The market for them has always been there. Ever since anyone, a mom, a dad, could actually take a wrench and change something on a car, it's always been there. And it's always been huge. You had companies like American Racing supplying wheels to domestic motorheads before people even understood what a vehicle could actually do. The first vehicle, even the motor carriages that people got, they would modify and carve and make different. I mean, ever since this was even a conversation, people were making things different. You had companies like Enkei throwing wheels on Hondas when it was founded in Japan and being one of the first ones to understand the function and purpose of lightweight barrels on their wheels and what rotational mass meant and all of that good stuff. You had enthusiasts building enthusiast wheels and making a ton of money. But over time, you had some things change. All right, you see, in general, the production of automobiles across the world grew more as decades passed. It never really shrunk down. And even while you were fighting with the 70s of the EPA and things like that, production always pretty much went up. And while many manufacturers in China, Japan, India, Russia, and even America were trying to make every single part for its cars, they just couldn't do it all, and they really didn't want to. Parts that required aluminum alloy casting, heavy use parts like tires, and all the fluid stuff wasn't something that they could really make on their own, nor did they really want to. Turns out Ford wasn't very excited about that sort of stuff, so they outsourced a lot of it. So as car manufacturers entered the 50s, 60s, and 70s, they started reaching out to more and more aftermarket companies to help produce, you guessed it, car parts, because the supply and demand started to not equal out. Parts for their Fords, Hondas, Chevys, and so forth, everything that they could imagine, as demand increased, supply had to meet it. And a lot of initial aftermarket wheel companies made just that, only aftermarket stuff. So when car manufacturers came to them and said, hey, we're looking to get a few thousand sets of wheels for our car, if you'd be interested. And like, Enkei was like, I mean, should we do it? Yeah, we're good. Yep, got it, sounds good. And that is pretty much what happened. And aftermarket wheel companies began making wheels for OE specifications, wheels specifically for the production of factory normal, lame, boring, slow-ass cars, all right? Because guess what? There was this thing called money, and it actually made them very happy. It allowed them to supply a lot of their aftermarket wheels. You got things like JWL and BIA testing become established for places like Japan, while the United States and other countries develop testing programs and standardization for their vehicles as well to make sure that these aftermarket wheel companies made wheels that would be safe to use. Companies like Enkei, BBS, and Ronal began making not only aftermarket wheels, but also OE stuff in in larger quantities to help support everything else that the companies were trying to do, because back then they weren't as big as they are now. Car production grew and the needs of manufacturers grew along with it. So now companies that used to be maybe doing about 5% of OE production became 50-50. Then over the years, it became 60-40. And now for a lot of companies in 2020, it can be upwards of 90-10. The volume, ease of manufacturing once compliance is met, and contract-based agreements were pretty appealing to aftermarket wheel companies, and people like you and people like me are a little less stable than a multi-million dollar contract. You can't even pin me down to get me to show up to dinner on time. You think I'm gonna pay for a multi-million dollar reason? You're out of your mind. The production of OE wheels for these companies began taking more time, more volume, and more priority than the aftermarket wheel industry. Not just that, but you had the volume, all right? The volume was there, all right? The compliance standpoint also was a lot harder to meet in the OE market than it is in the aftermarket market, because you have rigidity testing, radial fatigue testing. OE compliance as a whole just requires a lot more work than slapping together a three-piece wheel and throwing it on a car because it looks neat. Because ultimately, those wheels have to stay alive for decades and decades and decades. They can't just bend, they can't just randomly break. And because of that, it put a lot of pressure on these aftermarket wheel companies to make OE wheels. They just could not fail. That ends up taking companies more time, more research, more money over and over as car manufacturers change body styles every 3 years for some reason, brakes across 9 different trims and different fitments across 7 different pieces of land, because what you get here in the United States is different than what you get in Japan, which is different than what you get in Europe, which is different than what you get in Australia. The last one's probably not true, but because of all the variation, it caused these wheel manufacturers to really start to spread out the amount of focus and time that they had to support OE production. But why does that matter for shiny wheels in an 18x9.5+22? Well, because the 5-spoke ugly boys that are on your town and country make more sense to a company that would probably produce both. One is low volume, it's low consistent form of revenue. Money, all right? And the other is massive volume, constant form of revenue through contracts and more. And guess what? Companies like Enkei and others put a ton of faith into their effort, into their OE production, where now the aftermarket support could and has dwindled a little bit when compared to companies that solely focus on aftermarket wheel design, aftermarket wheel production, and everything like that. So over the years, things have switched. Companies that used to make, you know, both are now focusing more heavily on one side. And unfortunately for people like you and people like me, it's not the side we usually want. This switch causes aftermarket wheel companies to release less new designs. It has, by and large, less support, and it reduces the amount of focus in the overall aftermarket scene. And that is what makes me sad, okay? Some say that the aftermarket support is still there and stronger than ever, but when you actually take a look at it, when you compare a brand that does have both compared to a brand that doesn't, there's just no comparison. Pair that with OE manufacturers generally not wanting you to swap out their wheels, and you have a double negative where the odds just keep stacking up. But here's the great news. There's more aftermarket wheel companies than ever before. Companies that solely focus on aftermarket wheel design and not OE production. It's just a lot of the older companies are now starting to focus on OE production because it's a long-term investment. Sure, not all these new companies are 50 years old or from overseas, but the fact that there are companies continuing to support the community with other new companies and new wheels is pretty badass. You have incredible stories like Rotiform from the 2010s, Chris from Kansei, and even, well, I mean, us with Artisa Wheels. So while we may continue to see the older companies beginning to evolve into more mature OE style production and less aftermarket because they like money and it's way easier than aftermarket wheels, people like us will catalyze companies that love to support making our cars less reliable and way more fun. But what do you think? Let us know what you'd like us to talk about next. And if you're looking for aftermarket wheels, tires, or suspension, be sure to hit us up over at fitmentindustries.com. I'm Alex from Fitment Industries. I'm gonna finish the coffee that's in my little flower cup because I didn't have another coffee cup. Don't judge me. We will see you later. Peace.